we're going to like take some explosives to our brain right now, okay? So that's relevant to some of you. This thing really blew my mind when I started thinking about this. We talked about the fall, right? That the work is going to be more and more difficult until Christ returns. So what happens when he comes back? And Adam's curse is no more, as it states in Revelation 22:3, which says, no longer will there be any curse. That doesn't mean there's no swearing in heaven. I mean, I can't imagine there would be, but they're referring to the curse of Adam back in Genesis 3. And this is really immediately following Revelation 21, which we're going to read here in a second. So the curse is no more. So Revelation 21, 1 to 5, and again, I didn't spend a lot of time studying it as a young Christian, and until recently, I really haven't studied it. But, you know, we're trying to look at a biblical perspective on work from Genesis to Revelation and everything in between. So Revelation really, we start looking at this, it really expands your mind a little bit. In Revelation, it gives the description of what to expect at the consummation, which is after Jesus returns and the judgment of Satan and his followers is complete. And here it is that he says, and John the Apostle is describing what he sees. Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth. And it's kind of like salt and pepper. They kind of go together, right? They go together on the table. For the first heaven, the first earth had passed away, and there was no longer any sea. That's interesting. Sea separates us, so we're going to have one big place. I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down from heaven, from God, prepared as a bride beautifully dressed for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, look, God's dwelling place is now among the people, and he will dwell with them. There's that God's presence. Now we see it by faith. Now we see it glimpses. Then we're going to see it completely, fully. He will dwell with them. They will be his people. God himself will be with them and be their God. This is the good stuff. He will wipe every tear from their eyes. There will be no more death or mourning or crying or pain, for the old order of things has passed away. He who was seated on the throne said, I am making everything new. Then he said, write this down, for these words are trustworthy and true. Kind of a long section, but I really never had looked at that much before. So they're describing a place called New Jerusalem, which is a city, which is what the new earth is going to be like. So we're not going to be, heaven is not a place of disembodied spirits sitting on clouds playing harps all day. Okay? New Jerusalem comes down where God will dwell for all eternity with those whose names are written in the Lamb's Book of Life, and there's no more death or sadness or pain. Sounds like fun. So Whitmer, my professor, in a book that I read that he wrote, reminds us that God didn't say, I'm making new everything, but rather, I'm making everything new. He doesn't promise to make new things to furnish the new earth, but to renew the things that are already here. Oh, now my mind exploded. So what is that? Another book I read called The Heavenly Value of Earthly Work said, our sanctified imaginations can only suggest what we think God's promise to make all things new might mean. There will be no doubt some specific products of our work that through judgment will be transformed and incorporated into the new physics of the new creation. All right? I am quite hoping that the Handel's Messiah will be regularly in concert in the New Jerusalem. So, we shall see. My professor in his book, he suggests that Bach and Michelangelo will be there plenty of time to create even better works. Now, I've got no idea what Bach will be composing, but I do know for a fact that he will not be decomposing.